gonna try, see if we can get across that interstate bridge with the headers on and try to make it across this thing.
Or that is sketchy.
Hey, welcome back to the channel. We're going into winter wheat today. Got the combines ready. I'm excited. Wheat is always fun to harvest. It makes up the majority of our cropland. We got these big machines to roll through it. They're just about tuned and set. Washed some windows off, washed a couple areas off. Let's do it. Let's get in some wheat. Let's go, guys. This might seem a little odd to you guys, but one thing we do every year is we take a combine and we cut all the grass down around the Quonset, around all of our bins and everything. Well, it's the easiest way to mow the grass down. Just some expensive mowing hours, that's all.
This building here, earlier this spring we cleaned it out, hauled all that into town. Because we don't have enough storage on this farm, we're gonna put grain back into this building and it's gonna be winter wheat. We figured there's about 15,000 bushels we can stick in this building. So we're gonna go ahead and as they're cutting, we're gonna bring the first load in here. We're gonna dump it, keep filling, see how that goes.
It's averaging probably between 30 and 40 bushels an acre. This area is pretty poor ground, so I don't expect much. But unfortunately, we've got a lot of soft fly damage. And I guess we were kind of expecting there probably be some, but there's more than we thought. Soft fly is basically a little fly that burrows into the stem of the wheat earlier in the year, lays a little egg. The egg hatches into a larva. The larva then eats around the wheat stem, turns into a beautiful another fly, flies off, and then that stem eventually falls over on the ground. It still produces kernels, which is surprising. I'm sure there's some reduction, but so what's happened is basically it's like having a bunch of fruit trees, only someone took an axe and cut them all down on the ground, but your machine to pick up those fruit trees is above the ground. So you have to find ways to try to pull that grain that's on the ground, the wheat, back up to get in your header. And it's not easy, because you can see here, whole bunch of wheat stems on the ground that I'm not getting. So there's heads down there. So we might have to do something about this. I'm hoping this is just this field. We'll see what happens when we get into our bigger winter wheat field. But if it's across the board, we got to do something about it. That's money on the ground that we can't get unless we put some adapters onto our headers. So hey, it's a bummer. Well, the conclusion is, guys, we're gonna put the guards on. They're honeybee pickup guards. We've used them throughout the years on our old headers. The last like 5 or 6 years, we haven't put them on because we haven't had a need to, but sawflies are making a return on the farm. It's just the unfortunate part about growing winter wheat crops is you're gonna deal with sawflies. The more you put in, the more sawflies you're gonna get. But we love winter wheat because it usually yields better than spring wheat and is typically a pretty reliable crop. So like this, so like that, on the ground. That didn't get picked up by the combine because of the sawfly. So let me go over here and give a hand to these guys. They're putting them on right now. We've got enough to do about every foot and a half on the header, about every 18 inches. So we're just gonna go ahead and put everyone we've got on. Normally you want them a little closer than that, but that's all we have on the farm right now because we've got more header than we used to have. But that's okay. It'll work out good. We'll try it. I'm sure this will be a good fit. Oh, there, that's good. You know, I'm not really excited to run these. The reason why we don't like these is because they're scooting along the field, these are dragging on the ground, all of a sudden a big old rock's right there, boom, hits the rock. Rock flies up in your header, goes down the canvas, goes in your feeder house, boom, broken feeder chain, or worse, it gets past your rock beater, gets into your rotor, $10,000, $20,000 worth of damage. If we don't do this, let's just say we have 1,000 acres of winter wheat and it yields 40 bushels an acre and $5 a bushel, 40,000 bushels times $5, $200,000, $200,000. Now let's just say lost 10% to sawfly on the ground. So 10% of $200,000 is $20,000. So these babies right here could save us up to $20,000 this year just by running them. 20 grand, boom, back in our pockets. Or you could run a rock into the combine and cause $20,000 worth of damage. That's very unlikely though. Let's get to harvesting. I just heard a nasty clunk, 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 and then my feeder alarm went off. So I got a rock out here. I don't know if it's the only one. I probably should be going a little slower, honestly, instead of pushing like I am. Let's see the damage that was done. Now there's one right here. You don't want that in your combine. Dirt clump. Let's dump my rock trap. See what's going on here. Why am I always downwind when I do that?
Yeah.
Every time. Wind is always going the wrong way. It's going from the east right now. It never goes that way. Blowing that way. Whatever. It's okay. I can blow myself off later. Oh, there's the rock. Well, I'm gonna have to grab some tools, pop the covers off the feeder house, take a look inside, see if I can get that rock. It's in there somewhere and it's not going in and it's not going out, so I'm gonna have to force it out.
Found it.
That's a feeder chain bar. I'll be able to bend that back in the shop and the press. And we're gonna have to get more of these because I don't think we have any spares. That is the downside of running those things. And this is not gonna be the first. What do? You gotta get the wheat off the ground. It's the life of being a farmer. Well, I can run without this. There's an ore in there. It's not gonna slow my capacity down that much with this kind of crop we're cutting. We've also got another dilemma, guys. I keep changing hats. Besides that dilemma, we're up against a little bit wet rain. We thought for sure it'd be ripe by now, but digging around in the grain samples and doing some tests, it's just borderline. And we're putting this in a building, no aeration, on the floor. And the last thing we wanna do is have a wreck. You don't wanna put wet wheat on the floor. We don't have any other ripe or winter wheat, so we might have to shut down for the day. But we're trying a couple different moisture tests because we just wanna confirm and see is this good? So we'll do another test and find out. So this is a moisture tester. There's an old one over there. We've used that one for years and that one has been pretty reliable. It's been pretty accurate. So we already put the sample in it. Press the test button. It's testing 12.5% and 80 degrees Fahrenheit. You have to count the temperature as well, but I think this thing does it automatically. So that one's 12.5%. Now we'll check the old one and compare and just make sure if they're on the same page. The consensus is it's on the edge. We're not real comfortable with the moisture it's getting. So we have our winter wheat split up on both sides of the farm. One's on one side is like 10 miles away that way. And our dilemma is the rain is coming this weekend. We're talking a half inch. If it rains that much, that'll shut us down for 3 or 4 days easy. So here's what we're trying to figure out is how can we get the most acres in done before the rain comes? Well, if we can't really cut this, if this is just on the edge, that stuff 10 miles from here, if it's more ripe, we might as well pack up, head over there and start cutting on that and get that knocked out. And then whatever time we have left to work on this. But if it's greener over there, then that means we should wait, let this ripen a day. So take tomorrow off and then hit this hard, get this 500 acres all knocked out before the rain, and then we'll get that stuff across the interstate next week after it dries up. Get me? Okay, let's go for a drive. Sawfly. That's what those guards are for. So we're over here. This is like literally 10 miles on the other side of the farm. Winter wheat looks better over here. This looks like a nice winter wheat stand. This is promising. If you look carefully down there, you can see there's a lot on the ground still. Or it's on the ground. It's on its way to go to the ground. That's what those pickup guards are for, is they'll pick that up. I'm thinking this actually might be riper than the other stuff, which means we're gonna make the long journey over here. It's gonna be fun. Well, it's almost 8:40 and we have some daylight still. And I think the plan, we're gonna go ahead and just run the combines over there. And we're gonna try, see if we can get across that interstate bridge with the headers on. And if we can't, then we'll park them there for the night, and then in the morning we'll take the headers off, carry them across in trailer mode, put them back on, and go to town. But I'm kind of thinking we might be able to get these things on, so let's see what we can do. Cruising, going 24 miles an hour through the field. These LSWs ride really nice. I'm telling you, they ride really nice. Here we go. Let's try it. I'm gonna try to make it across this thing.
Always waiting on farm equipment in the road, trying to get where I'm going.
Just tilting the header back and forth right now. Oh, tire's gonna hit. Just go through the cattle guard. That is sketchy. I'm sure everyone's wondering, why don't we just take the headers off? Well, we could. Yeah, buddy, made it. Flew a drone, had a GoPro on me, another GoPro doing a time lapse, and I free-handed that thing. A little crazy. Man, that could have gone south. I could have lost a drone or an LSW 1400 tire or part of the header. Why didn't we just take the headers off and pull them in the pickup? Because now we know we can do it. Okay, let's park these combines, shut it down, and go to bed. Good morning.
We're shuttling everything over to the other side of the farm. That includes the Brute, the service truck, Fummins, International's over here too. Then Legarm's gonna come back and he's gonna move the auger, put it over a bin, a bunch of stuff, because we gotta go to a whole different area. All the greens go in a different spot, everything. So it's a big shuffle of like 10 different vehicles, but compared to like cutter crews, we're still small potatoes.
All right, fire truck's in the field. He hasn't had a use yet, thank goodness. But if that day comes and we get a fire, I'm by golly gonna use Big Brute to fight that thing. Oh, hey, it's B-Spine. One more thing to take over there. So I get to drive it over across the interstate. I'm excited. Let's roll some coal. She is a little dirty though. Definitely gonna need a wash and some wax. But we'll do that after harvest. For now, it's working time. Roll coal cam. And check. Let's get rolling. Time. I don't know, guys. Seems like there's just too much green in this field. Every time I think I've got out of the green areas, then there's more green. And like right now, this is darker here. I'm seeing green in it. And it's not good to put this kind of moisture in our bins because we don't have forced aeration into those. And they're fairly large grain bins. And we could be dealing with potential mold issues if we keep doing this. So we're going to get to the end of the field, do a moisture test on this again. If we shut down for 2 days, it's gonna get rained on, and then it'll be another 2 or 3 days to be ready. I don't know. It'd be really nice to finish this before the rain, but I'm nervous. I don't think it's gonna work, so we might have to make a call here and maybe shut the things down. Well, we went and tested the moisture. It came in at about 15.3, 15.5. We're pretty sure that's pretty consistent to what this field's running. That's too wet to put in a bin or building without aeration. These bins that we have don't have aeration. So we're gonna shut down for now. I'm just closing it off. We might have to wait a couple days, but we'll see if we get time, if it ripens up enough to get back in the field before the rain comes. Hopefully the rain is not gonna happen, but they're forecasting it could. So I guess we're done for the day. So no matter what happens during harvest, the ups and downs, there's one thing that we all look forward to, and that's lunchtime. And we're far enough away from the farmyard that we're gonna have lunch in the field. This is a tradition we've had for years. It's typically what farms do. And the wives will bring out food, bring out tables, chairs. I just pulled up, cooling the combine down. I see my wife just pulled up with the kids. And I'm gonna shut this baby down. I'm gonna eat some grub. Thank you.